Thank you. I'm Raphael. This doesn't work as it should. Yeah. I work here at HSR, at the Institute for Software. And I do software development in the field of GIS. This is Geo Information Systems. So processing geographic data with software. And today I want to talk to you about comprehensions. And this is a bit of a hands-on talk. So you can follow along on this tool that we just heard about before the break on MyBinder. And while you copy this URL, sorry, I didn't provide a short link. While you copy this URL, I can confess to you that most of this talk was inspired by and is also partially ripped off from List Comprehensions to Generator Expressions article by Guido. Some of you might have heard of him. He's the inventor of Python. And he, with some other authors, has this great series on the web, The History of Python, where this is one of the articles. The first comprehension that I want to talk about is the list comprehension. There's also dictionary and set comprehensions that have been introduced to Python later on. And list comprehensions were the first one to come to Python in the year 2000 in version 2.0. And in that article that I just mentioned, Guido describes them as a Pythonic interpretation of a well-known notation for sets used by mathematicians. And you may have seen this notation in your school time or maybe even later. Here's an example which can be read as the set of all x such that x is greater than 10. So this describes the set with some rules rather than enumerating all the elements. And so let's look at set notations in math. This is the explicit notation where you enumerate the elements, probably known to most of you. And does somebody recognize what set this could be? Anyone? Yeah. It's maybe a bit clearer even if I write it like this. This is clearly the set of square numbers, or at least a set that contains the first six square numbers, because we really don't know what follows here. Usually this should follow some rule, but we don't know whether this rule really is, that it is the square numbers. So if we write the set like this, if we say it's sum x squared such that x is an element of n, or such that x is a natural number, n is the set of natural numbers, then it's really clear this is the set of square numbers. Sorry? I'm still getting used to this notebook thingies. And this notation in math is apparently called the set builder notation. You can read the bar as such that or for which. So, as I told before, this can be read as the set of all x squares such that x is a natural number, or the set of all x squares for which x is a natural number. I don't know whether in math also the word comprehension is used as it is in Python. At least on Wikipedia, you find this under set builder notation if you want to look up more about this. And if you look at this more closely, we see first you have the curly braces at the beginning and the end to denote that this is a set, and the bar in the middle. And on the left-hand side of the bar is some expression on x, or on any variable, actually. And on the right side is a predicate for x. A predicate is like a condition, but not a condition that we want to test, rather one that we want to affirm. So we are looking for all the x squares that for which this condition is true. And if you want to do something like this in Python, we can do this with list comprehension. Now, I've talked all the time about sets now, and now I'm switching to lists. Why that? Well, Python 2.0, the version that introduced this feature, didn't even have sets, and so it didn't have set comprehensions either. And also, in programming, you also much more often need lists than you need sets. Sometimes you need sets, but often a list is actually what you need because you have something where the order matters, or where you can have several elements that are equal. But the principle is the same. We have the for keyword here, the in keyword here, these angular brackets, these square brackets to denote that this is a list, and here's some expression in X. It's just the multiplication formulation of the squares. And here on the right side, not a set, but an iterable. What is an iterable? An iterable is anything that you can iterate over in Python, so anything that you can use in a for loop. Here I'm using a range that gives me the numbers from 1 to 7. Or 1 to 6, actually. 7 is exclusive. And here we see the list written explicitly as a literal. I can show that the result is just the same. Here it's written with multiplications. And the result is again the same. And here now we have the list comprehension that actually computes this list if I run this. And like this, I can also produce the same result. Very handy. And if we look at the example from the very beginning, where we had the x that are larger than 10, now in Python this doesn't really work because here the predicate is just some rule, but we don't know where to take the volumes from. In math, this is not usually a problem because often a universal set is implied, usually by context. So from the context, we might know here that we are like talking about the integers, about the whole numbers, and the predicate would actually look like this. It's just not written down. And if we want to do something like that in Python, we can do that too. We can add some additional condition here in addition to the membership in the iterable. And sorry, I think, yeah, here. here I'm just generating some random numbers between minus 30 and plus 30, 25 of them. I'm also using list comprehension here, and I use it just for counting. I don't really care about the loop variable here, so this is in expression here can also be independent of the variable. And here, this is the list comprehension that I actually want to show you. It uses this list S here from before. I can maybe quickly show what S looks like. So these are just some numbers. And with this, I can filter them for the numbers that are greater than 10. And I can also do more fancy stuff, like have here the square numbers, here the cube numbers, and I want them to be between 10 and 100. And so, oh, sorry. Like this, I get only two numbers because there's only two square numbers for which the corresponding cube numbers are between 10 and 100. You might wonder why I've used only range 5 here. That is because I know that the cube of 5 is already above 100. And this can't be used only for numbers. Like, I can use some string here. And in Python, you can split strings at whitespace with the split function. And so I'm getting the individual words or word combinations where they don't have some space between them. And I can build some new sentences from that. I'm filtering for just the words that end in ing and putting them into some new sentences. So I've used numbers before because that's when you explain things with math, that's what's really close, but it's not the only thing that you can use. In that blog post of Guido, it's also described how list comprehensions can be seen as an alternative to the map and filter functions, and you might have come along them if you come from functional programming or if you've looked at what global functions Python has to offer. What the map function does, it takes some function and applies it to all the elements of an iterable. And the filter function returns all the elements of an iterable for which a condition, here denoted as the function p, is true. And so they are really equivalent to these list comprehensions. The one where we just apply the function and the other one where we just ask whether this condition is true. In Python 2, the results are exactly the same, because these also return lists. In Python 3, these functions return generators, something which I won't go into in this talk, but this is also some type of iterable that you can only iterate over once. So in Python 3, if you really want a list, you have to call the list function on the result, which converts this to a list. And if you have both, some function to apply here and a condition there, we can do the same thing by nesting the filter call in the map call. And as an example, let's look at finding the ASCII codes of all the capital letters in the following sentence. I can do that with map by applying the ORT function to get the ASCII codes. It's a function that's built into Python. Here, because I'm using Python 3, I get a map, and I can convert it to a list with the list function. This underscore here is just some convenience that is provided by JuPyter and also by IPython, and is a variable that holds the last result. So here it's this map object. And with the equivalence from before, I can do exactly the same with this list comprehension. Here I have to actually call the function on the individual elements, which I've called C because they are characters. And the result is the same. For filter, I'm using here the isUpper function of the string type. Which is true if the argument is all uppercase, and I'm iterating over the elements of the sentence, which are the individual characters, so the sentence is again still the same. If I run this, because Python 3, I get a filter object, and if I look at it as a list, I get the letters G, I, and S, the capital letters inside this sentence. And with the other equivalence from before, we can also write this as a list comprehension, here calling the filter function in the if clause. And we can write this even a bit more compact, because a character in Python really is also a string, just one with only one element. And so this function here, I can look at it as a method of this character and can call it like this. And if I combine both, I can nest it like this. The sentence is still the same. And get now the ASCII codes of these letters G, I, and S. And in the list comprehension, I can do, I can apply the function here. And use the filter function here. It's mostly the same as before, except now combined. And the result is, of course, again, the same. And again, I can slightly shorten this by omitting the type here and calling this directly on the object. So what can I do with the result? I could do some computations with these numbers, or I can just convert it back. And what coincidence, I get GIS, the field that I'm working in. And before I look into when you should use filter and map and when you should use list comprehensions instead, I want to quickly tell you about the other type of comprehensions. Dictionary comprehensions were added in Python 3 in the year 2008 and were backported to Python 2.7, which was released in 2010. And they look similar here as list comprehensions for this for part. The difference is the curly braces, like you have for dictionary literals, and the colon here, which separates the key and the value. And both of these are expressions which can use this loop variable. So like this, we can, for example, again, using the ORT function, generate the table of all printable ASCII characters. And you can also iterate over dictionaries. This is the ASCII table just from before, the dictionary I just created. And if you iterate over a dictionary just like that, you'll get only the keys. If you want the keys and the values, then you have to iterate over the result of the items method. You can unpack this into two values and use this again in the expressions for key and value. Here, I'm just using it to switch key and value. So I get the characters mapped to the integers that represent them in ASCII. Set comprehensions have been added in the same versions. And what is interesting, I think, is that they've been added together with the literal syntax for sets. You didn't have that in any version before these. It's actually the same syntax as you know from math, with commas between the elements and curly braces to denote the set. What you have to be careful about is that the empty curly braces is still the empty dictionary. So to write an empty set, you have to still call the set function, which is still available. Other than that, set comprehensions aren't too fancy. They look just the same as dictionary comprehensions, except that you have curly braces instead of square braces. And of course, the difference is here, I've used an iterable with some duplicates. And in the set, the duplicates are gone because sets don't contain duplicates. So before we've seen that we can list comprehensions and the functions map and filter for mostly the same purpose, and this is a bit of a problem because Python has some design rules that you can look at if you import this. And one of them is that there should only be one way to do things, or one obvious way to do things. And it might not be obvious when to use list comprehensions and when to use map and filter. And it has been suggested in the past to do away with map and filter, but they are still there, and they are useful. So maybe we have to look at the other rules. Like most of all, readability counts, but also let is better than nested. And the most beautiful rule, beautiful is better than ugly. So if we have an expression and a predicate that are already defined as unary functions, Like in this example here, where we use the board function that is built into Python, then we can have this map call or this list comprehension here. The list comprehension is slightly longer, and I think here I have a slight preference for the map call, but the list comprehension is also quite nice. It depends a bit whether you are doing functional programming in that part of the program. If you do, maybe map is more natural than the list comprehension. Similarly for filter, here you have this isUpper function and the corresponding list comprehension here, but I would also slightly prefer the filter call. But if you have reasons to use the list comprehension here, that's fine too. Now, if you have both of them combined, you would have to nest them if you want to do this with map and filter. And here you have this flat is better than nested rule, so I think here the list comprehension would be to prefer, unless there might be other ways to unnest this. Because really, let's face it, the conversion to ASCII codes and the filtering, while they are chained, they aren't really related to each other. So it might be even more readable if we just make this two lines, separate the calls, and give the intermediate results some speaking names. But sometimes you have the case where there aren't any functions already defined. So you could define them, like here I have a function that tells me whether a character is a vowel. And I could define it and then use it in a filter call. Or if I don't want to give it a name, I could define it inline as this lambda, which is just an anonymous function, and use it like that. And in the list comprehension, I don't have to do this because here I can directly use an expression as the condition. So here I think the list comprehension would be to prefer. And it's even more clear if we have functions that are not yet defined and we have problems naming them when we define them. Like here I've made up some function, but it could happen with actual useful function too. I've named it Boogify because I couldn't think of any better name. And sometimes you have this function where what they do is actually the best description of what they do, and no name can get any closer to it. And of course, you can use a lambda again to avoid having to name the function, or you could just use a list comprehension, which I think here is clearly to prefer. And again, if you have functions that are not yet defined, you would have to define them, and then you would have to nest the map and the filter call, and well, even first define the functions or use these lambdas, then it's, I think, very clear that the list comprehension is to prefer, unless you have other reasons to define the functions. Like if there is an option for reuse for them, then defining them might be fine. Of course, you could define them and still use them in the list comprehension. That also works. So here, I think it's a very clear preference for list comprehensions. What does this do? I've just made up some example, but didn't really show what it's good for. It's actually not good for much. It just converts the vowels into sentence into some kind of baby speech. And yeah, that's it. Of course, if I do this in a list comprehension, I can get the same result. So that was a quick introduction to the different kinds of comprehensions we have in Python. If you can, look into generator expressions. They're also very interesting, but a topic that's a bit more advanced, so I didn't cover that here. And now I'm ready to answer your questions.
Thank you, Rafael. I think we have time for one or two questions. I see some hands over there.
Can you do infinite sets, like in Scala?
With list comprehensions, you can't, because the result is a list, and a list has to be finite. Syntactically, it's perfectly correct, but evaluating it would just not terminate.
So there's no lazy equivalent
of the there is one, and that is generator expressions. A generator expression is written just the same, but with round parentheses around this for loop, and that is lazily evaluated, so you can do infinite stuff there and just get as many values from it as you need to. The downside is you can only iterate over it once, so if you have something that actually is finite and you iterate fully over it and you want to iterate over it another time, then it will just give you no elements anymore.
Thanks.
Hi, thanks. Okay. So when you were before comparing the different ways of writing this list comprehension, the alternatives, you mentioned that you would choose one or another depending yeah. on the convenience. But what about speed? Do they have the same speed if I do it one way or another? Execution speed.
In Python 3, I think they have very comparable speeds. In Python 2, I'm not sure. I think there was a bigger difference, but I don't remember which one was quicker. I think that the comprehensions might have been more performant in Python 2. But in Python 3, the difference, I think, is negligible in most of the cases, because in there has also been quite some optimization going on to make this fast. There might be more on that in the article by Guido that I mentioned. He goes into some of the performance considerations, but without looking actually at the implementation, just stating some comparisons.
I thought we had another question over there.
Oh, okay.
That was efficient.
No more questions?
Well, all right, looks like we don't have any questions anymore, so let's thank
Thanks for your attention.